Welcome to this week's edition of the Don Cherry's Grapevine Podcast. In keeping with the social distancing guidelines, we're still going to be running the Don Cherry Grapevine interviews. Hopefully next week we will be back with the regular podcast with Dad and Cindy and Dell. But this week we have a 1984 interview with two-time Stanley Cup champ and one of the toughest guys ever to play the game, Dave the Hammer Schultz.
Tonight in the Grapevine we got Dave the Hammer Schultz, the most popular player in the Broad Street Bullies, the Philadelphia Flyers. Are you ready, Blue? I'm ready. Let's go meet the Hammer.
Welcome to Don Cherry's Grapevine, the spot where you get the inside on the world of sports. And now, here he is, Mr. Don Cherry.
Oh, good. Proud. Small, but good. Hey, you guys. Hey, smoking there. Ken McKenzie. Hockey news right there. Hockey news right there. Well, there he is over there. It's my gangster outfit. She's mine. Right here, the smiling Irishman, Jimmy Loftus.
Jimmy! A lot of good drinkers here tonight, Fritz.
Yeah, they sound like they're having a good time, I'll tell you that.
Did you notice who dropped in for a jar?
For a jar?
Bob Gainey.
What do they say that? In Ireland, a jar? We say here a pint. Bob Gainey, captain of the Montreal Canadiens. Right there. Grouchy sends his regards.
I could send him something back.
Whoa! Oh. Next year, Bob.
Grapes, I heard you played against Dave.
Well, Dave the Hammer Schultz, he's a good guy, and he was tough, and he was honest, and I saw him start. I know a lot of people. I played till I was 38 years old. I beat you on that one. 38 years old in the American Hockey League, and he played for the Richmond Robins. I was near the end, you know. I was doing the best I can and trying. I couldn't get a job any other place. I made a comeback and trying to scrape through, and we went down to Richmond. The place was jammed. Now, they never drew anything down there before. 1,500, you walked in, there was 6,000 plus. So I go out on the ice, and all of a sudden, I see this curly-headed guy come out, Fu Manchu, great big guy. I mean, I'm telling you, was he a monster. And he had an act going you couldn't believe. I mean, it was unbelievable. He had the whole league buffaloed, and I said, this guy's got a great act. He's going to end up in the NHL. Well, you know what he did. You know Blue. She's got a Blue movie.
Yeah.
She's going to show it. You're going to see Dave the Hammer Schultz on the Blue movie right here.
Fisticuffs and Dave Schultz have always seemed to go hand in hand, and although home for the NHL tough guy may have been Waldheim, Saskatchewan, his big league hockey home was the penalty box. Dubbed the Hammer, Schultz is the all-time leader in NHL penalty minutes. His total time of 2,294 in just over 8 seasons is indicative of just how tough a competitor he really was. Hammer and Dave would lead the NHL in penalty minutes 3 times. Referred to by many as a hockey goon, Schultz defied the critics in 1974 by scoring 20 goals as the Philadelphia Flyers won their first Stanley Cup. Under the tutelage of Freddie Shiro, diplomacy was replaced by a might as right feeling in the Flyer camp. Combining forces with Don Selesky and Bob Kelly, the Roughhouse Flyers were nicknamed the Broad Street Bullies. Their fierce style of play caught opposing teams off guard, and the Flyers would sweep to a pair of impressive cup wins. After 4 seasons in Philadelphia, Schultz would spend the remainder of his NHL career in Los Angeles, Pittsburgh, and then Buffalo. Retirement followed in 1979 as the NHL bid farewell to one of the toughest hard-nosed characters ever to lace up a pair of skates in the professional ranks, Dave the Hammer Schultz.
I wanted to ask you, why did they call him the Hammer?
Oh, he worked as a carpenter in the off-season, Jimmy. Don't worry about it. Now, we're going to commercial now, but don't you go away. Dave the Hammer will be here. Here you Jerry. Come on. Well, welcome back to the Grapevine. Now, everybody, let's get ready. Here he comes, Dave the Hammer Schultz, right here. Hey, here we go, Dave, boy.
Hi, everyone.
Right here, Dave. Nice ring. I like that.
Thank you.
Two of them. Look at that. Pretty nice, eh? We get a shot of that. Am I throwing somebody off? Throw them over there, Dave. Throw them over there.
This is thanks to the Boston Bruins and Don Cherry.
Geez, a lot of guys thank me on that. You remember me when I was in Richmond and played for against you when I played for Rochester?
Well, I remember you, and I saw your name in the lineup, but for some reason, I don't know whether you requested it, but your coach never put you out there when I was out there.
Yeah, that's true. I remember once in the corner, you pushed me around a little. I pushed you back. But I remember you did sell out the building there all the time. And, you know, I still say, and another thing, too, Philadelphia Flyers, you know, they got criticized 3 or 4 years ago. Everywhere you guys went, you sold out the arenas everywhere. And it was, you know, I think it was color and things like that. Now, I know you don't like to talk about fighting and that, but I'm going to talk about it because it's my show. Now, Stan Jonathan and Al Secord and maybe one other, they're guys that like to fight. I don't think Terry O'Reilly likes to fight. We'll get into Terry later. Did you really like to fight?
Not really. I enjoyed the rewards I got. The anticipation of the fights, you know, was nerve-wracking, particularly, which didn't take long for me to develop a reputation in the league. I already had one in the American League. And, of course, Fred Shero knew what I was doing down there. And I soon showed him that if a certain situation happened, that I'd be out there and doing my thing. And it was that anticipation of knowing that most of the people in the stands, plus my teammates, et cetera, that if something happened out there, I was probably the guy. We had a few other guys on our team, but I was probably the guy that was going to do something. And when you have a reputation like that, it's not that I was worried about getting hurt physically, necessarily, but I didn't want to lose. And there was times when I lost, and I even got really hurt.
Yeah, there was something here, right?
Did
Shero ever send you out? Did he ever say, Dave, go get that guy?
Well, when he heard that the Boston coach was sending guys out, he... he never ever said... At a particular time during the game, Dave, go get that guy. But when I knew it wasn't my turn to go on the ice, I knew that. But all of a sudden, I was mentioned to go on the ice after a particular incident. I mean, I kind of knew what I was supposed to do, and I. On the other hand, I'd already showed him that I would do that.
Yeah, I know how to do it. You don't really send a guy out. Say there was John Rattel. Donnie Marcotte's line, Schultz, and then something had happened out there, I'd say, okay, next line out, Rattel, Schultz, and Winsink. So you know he wasn't going out there to dance, as they say. And you know, I do relate to you because, and I don't look at it because I'm so handsome now, but actually I played till I was 36 years old, and up until I was about 32, I that's what I had to do. I had to go out, and he's exactly right. I couldn't put it in words. You weren't afraid of losing, getting cut. You were afraid of losing in front of your teammates and all that. And you know, I come along and I remember when Jonathan come up and Winsink come up, they were not O'Reilly, but those two guys could hardly wait. You were like the top gunfighter. They were in the minor leagues. And there were two on our club waiting for you, and it must have been tough going into every city like that.
Boston was the worst. I mean, you already had O'Reilly. And then you had to come up with Winsick and Jonathan, and then Secord, which I never ever got involved with him. But, I mean, if anything happened when we were playing the Boston Bruins, I mean, who was going to take care of it on the Flyers? And there was too many of you guys.
Yeah, and there was about five of us. And I remember in your book, you said that you didn't want to... night before a game, you played the Boston. You couldn't sleep because you were afraid. What were you afraid of? Why were you afraid?
Well, again, it was the whole anticipation of what might happen. And when you're playing Boston, you know something's going to happen.
And
it'd be different if there was one guy. Yeah. As some teams had maybe one or two guys, but no, Boston had three or four. And then the fans in Boston, and then again when you hear that their coach is preparing some of these guys.
you know,
all this adds up to, I mean, I didn't want to think about it. I would check the schedule sometimes 2 weeks in advance, but when I saw Boston, I just didn't want to think about it and have it bother me for the next two weeks.
I know what you mean. Now, you and O'Reilly, I've been in hockey. I was in hockey for a long time. I have never seen two guys, and not dirty, no sticks. There wasn't one stick. I don't ever remember ever giving a stick to one another. Played about 4 years together, and you two guys went at it every game. And you had a lot of respect for you. Did you have a respect for Terry?
A lot of respect.
And
I respect him even beyond his aggressive way of playing. But I mean, he went on to score a lot of goals, and the reports I got was a real team leader. But I certainly respected him. And it just seemed like every time we were out there, if anything happened, it would seem like we ended up together.
And I didn't put you out there against him. It just seemed it happened that way.
Yeah.
You know, I remember that one check. Maybe everybody tells it. You know, you talk to Terry, and he says, what check, you know, was best? And do you remember that check?
That dirty check?
No, it was your shoulder.
He got 2 minutes for elbowing, so.
Yes, his elbow had to be up on his shoulder. But anyhow, but do you remember that check? That was, you were cutting behind the...
I don't really remember because I had a slight concussion from it, to be honest with you.
I was
just getting ready to, you know, and again, my great goal-scoring ability, I get cerebral palsy when I get the puck in front, and I was looking down, and Terry really did nail me with a good one and sent me back.
That was a beauty. I thought, I loved it. Anyhow, I got it on tape. I show it every once in a while to get myself out. Now, you fellas were the Broad Street Bullies. You had that guy, remember, with the helmet? Remember they had Schultz's army and all that stuff? Yeah, it was color, though. It must have been fun.
It was exciting. I mean, aside from the success we had in the city of Philadelphia, which was the city of losers before we had the championship, I mean, they were starving for a championship in anything. And again, the way we won it, I mean, we were criticized all over the league, a rivalry with New York and with Boston. It couldn't have been written any better the way it happened.
Yeah, and Bobby Orr at that time and the whole deal.
It was exciting. And, no doubt about
and
that.
The parade after was really something, I'll bet.
It was, I just wish I'd have been more aware of, I mean, things happen so fast.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Like things like that, you don't appreciate them while they're going on. You know, when Terry O'Reilly, I just keep bringing him in, but he's very resentful when you talk of him as an enforcer. If you go up to him and stuff like that. Now, you got 20 goals. You never played the power play. I mean, I really believe they got rid of you too soon. Did you resent the idea that everybody called you the enforcer?
Not at the time. I knew that if I didn't improve my skills and whether it's being a better defensive player, I mean, they certainly didn't rely on me for goal scoring, although I scored a few goals here and there, and I felt I could have scored more if given the chance. I knew that if I didn't keep improving as a hockey player, somebody would come along that was as tough, as big and as tough, with more hockey skills and would replace me. And in essence, that's what happened when Paul Holmgren came along.
Yeah.
But at the time, I was on such a roll with the success the Flyers were having, which coincided our whole image. I mean, I was just doing my thing.
Boy, I'll tell you, do anything. Everywhere we went, we'd pick up the paper. We were coming into town. All we'd read about is Schultz. I mean, you were on cover of magazines and things like that. There's one fight I don't know whether you regret or not. It was that. Do you ever regret that fight with Rolf? Dale Rolf. He really did a number on
the
Rolf.
Only I don't regret it, the fact that supposedly, I mean, people can say things that it was a turning point in the game, which was the seventh game of the semifinals. And they say someone should have come to his aid, et cetera. Well, it was a poor time for someone to get a third man in. But I look at myself in the same situation. For a guy to be, in a way, humiliated. I mean, the guy wasn't a fighter, although he started it.
Yeah, we started it. Yes, he said, "What are you doing, Mr. Schultz?" Whack! But, you know, I saw you after you left Philly, and I saw you in Pittsburgh and L.A. Remember that one game in L.A.? I, you know, it, I felt so sorry for Inelli because they were really a gutless team at the time. They absolutely had nobody to come to a rescue. In the first period, you had a fight with Terry O'Reilly. The second period, that was when Milbury jumped you from behind, tried to choke you to death. Remember that? It's the truth. In the third period, Stan Jonathan got you, and not one guy came to your aid in that one.
I got one correction. Oh. I got Stan Jonathan.
Oh, you did? Oh, wow.
No, aside from that, really. In fact, I remember that game distinctly, particularly when Milbury grabbed me from behind and...
choked you.
He was hanging on for whatever reason. But I don't know if it was that game or another game when I got... it was a case where I fought Terry O'Reilly twice in one game there. And the second time, for no reason. And it was just like we were both out there and something happened and we grabbed each other. Instead of just holding on, it was just an automatic reaction. Well, I guess we got to fight. And I wasn't concentrating. He flipped me to the ice, almost killed me.
I remember hit your
head. I couldn't get out of the bed for a week.
Yeah, I remember
and
that.
And I got cartilage torn in my ribs, which still
I remember that. He put his foot behind you and down. And but I'll tell you, the guys had a lot of respect for you, and I'll tell you that. Now I hear they're making a movie of your book. Who's going to play you, Robert Redford or something?
Well, there's reports that someone was interested in a script, but at this time there's nothing. I wouldn't say that would happen at all.
It was a good book. Now listen, you were a commissioner of the Atlantic Coast League, is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah, he was a commissioner, can you imagine that? There's hope for me yet. Anyhow, what would you do to a guy if he acted like you did? How many games would you get him, say with Rolf? What would you do? Give him a medal or?
Well, to be honest with you, I'd probably treat it kind of like Clarence Campbell treated me. I had his personal phone number, and anytime there's an incident, he would honestly allow me to give my side of the story. And when I was commissioner, I was not concerned with guys who are fighting. I was concerned with the guys who would try and gouge an eye out or stick a guy in the face,
yeah, that's true.
That type of thing. And for a guy who would carry on like I did,
Life. Now, you must relate to Semenko out there, too. Now, Semenko, I think, really contributes to the Oilers. I really believe that he contributes to them, and he's a marked man. I see the very same thing happen to him that's happened to you. Another guy hits a guy, he gets it. You know what I mean?
Every team's always going to have those types of players. I think it's probably changed more where that type of a player, like I can use maybe an example of Barry Beck, who's really an all-star, but yet, is a pretty tough guy. There's not as much fighting in the league anymore. With the rule changes, there's not the need for a guy that basically his whole game plan is to go out there and take care of someone.
Do you like the way the game is today?
I would like to see more body checking,
absolutely,
more body contact.
We had Kenny Linsman on, and he said the game about 5 years ago played the way it should be played, and I agree. What moment in Philly, and I won't go to the other place, what moment in Philly stands out? Like, when you think of Philadelphia, what moment stands out?
Well, I guess winning the Stanley Cup, just the whole Boston series. Of course, there's a lot of things. The game against the Red Army team stands out in my mind, too.
That's when Clark almost broke the guy's ankle.
No, that was in Team Canada.
Oh.
But that was when Eddie Van Impe.
Oh, Eddie Van Impe almost.
Checked that guy, and for some reason they didn't want to play anymore.
Yeah. Well, listen, we got a commercial. We're going over to the bar. We're going to talk to Bob Gainey, my old buddy over there, Jimmy Loftus. Don't go away. The Hammer will be right back. Good. Back to the grapevine. Here's the Hammer. Bob Gainey here, Hammer, right here. I'm sure you've run into him a few times.
Couldn't catch him.
Listen, you were on the ice for one of his goals.
That's a rare occasion.
Oh, all right. Now, what are you doing today? You look in pretty good shape. How are you staying in such good shape?
I just don't eat.
Don't eat? You drink, though. Oh, a little.
Little.
Yeah. This is Jimmy Loftus here, the smiling Irishman,
nice
right there.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I was wondering what you do to relax or hobbies or...
I haven't done a whole lot to relax in the last couple of years. I'm involved in the cable industry down in the Philadelphia area, and I played very little golf. I haven't done a whole lot. I don't have any particular hobby
no
at this time.
No big hobby, no.
You're like me. You watch television. That's it. That's good enough. You worked hard during your career. Now, you give it to Clarkie pretty good. Bobby Clark in your book. In the Flyers. He took the guys out drinking and all that stuff. That's what he said. Now, what happened the first time you met Clarkie? Don't ask?
No, that's fine to ask. I hadn't talked to him up until I think it was about maybe a year ago. I had lunch with him, and we discussed a few things in regard to the comments I made, etc. And I think he probably understands more so than some of my other teammates, to be honest with you.
Were they mad at you too? Were a few guys?
Yeah, there's a few guys that unfortunately won't talk to me. They have an alumni there. I really maybe shouldn't admit this, but I mean, I'm not invited.
I'll tell you one thing. When they had their skating on the ice, you got the biggest hand of anybody of the whole Philadelphia Flyers when you skated on the ice that time, because I was there. Yeah. Now, let me ask you a question. If you had it all to do over again, like you're starting out at 20 years old and that, would you do it all the same way?
That's such a tough question, because I really enjoyed so much of it. On the other hand, there was a lot of negatives, but that's no matter what way I would have played. I probably wouldn't have tried to have got so locked into that role. Not only the way the fans viewed me, my teammates and management, but even in my own head. Yeah. I started thinking after, again, 3 years in the minor leagues, all I did was basically fight. Yeah. 4 years with the Flyers, that was my whole game plan.
Yeah.
Even after that, I kept thinking, why am I on this team when I start moving around? It's because I'm a fighter and the fans want to see some action. Well, I wouldn't have let myself
get into that there thing. Right. Well, listen, you were a colorful guy, and Terry O'Reilly and the Boston Bruins respect you. And Blue, take us home. Thanks a lot, Davey boy. Yeah, Bobby boy. I'll talk to you soon.